Welcome, everybody, back to the Friar Talk YouTube and podcast. Today, we have Ryan on. Kind of briefly brought it up on Twitter, but Ryan's got some special stuff to share with us today, and he's been here in the past, told us about a couple things that had happened in the past that were really cool that ended up happening. So, Ryan, I'll let you take the stage, man. What's going on right now with the Padres?
Well, thanks for having me back, Matt. I appreciate the opportunity to come on and talk. Right now, talks are a little slower than most deadlines. The draft is now pushed back to July due to obviously what happened last year. So you can expect this year's deadline to kind of be more of a last minute one where you're going to see kind of the last week or so, the last couple days where there's going to be a lot of rapid fire moves. Nothing really near the All-Star break, you know, kind of around where we're at right now. You know, GMs, especially, I've heard that AJ in particular is kind of not keen on making big moves or really any significant moves at all, unless they know what's coming back into their farm system from the draft. You know, that way they can really reassess where they're at and who they're willing to deal. But I've heard some pretty interesting names that he's gone after in trade talks early on. Obviously, things are just being discussed right now. Everything's in the early stages. But I think it's really telling as to his mindset right now. And I'll start off with the most shocking one. And I want everyone to just remember that this is not coming from me. I'm not, you know, BSing or anything like that. This is what I was told. AJ Preller brought up a trade with the Los Angeles Angels of Anaheim for Shohei Ohtani. Let that sink in for a second. Now, you've probably kind of seen hypotheticals on Twitter talking about the Padres trading for Ohtani, and, you know, sounds kind of ridiculous, but AJ Preller actually brought up a trade to the Angels for Shohei Ohtani. And, you know, one thing that kind of happens in sports is, you know, the bigger names don't really get traded, but everyone gets discussed. You know, I'm sure in the past, you know, Fernando Tatis Jr. might have even been discussed in a trade. Obviously, it's not something that would happen, but, you know, Shohei Ohtani's kind of the same situation. The Angels aren't, you know, particularly, you know, they don't want to trade him, but if somebody brings it up, especially someone like AJ Preller, who the Angels know is, you know, inclined to make aggressive moves and will part with significant prospect capital, they were willing to discuss with him, and the talks got surprisingly far. Obviously, no deal is likely. I'm told it's less than a 1% chance. But during this last series against the Reds in Cincinnati, the Angels even sent out a scout to watch Ryan Weathers and Mason Thompson, who the Angels were interested in being a part of a hypothetical package for him. Obviously, the Angels also asked for more prospects than the Padres were comfortable giving up. And plus, the Angels don't really want to move Shohei Ohtani. But I think there's a couple takeaways from this. Number one, Ohtani might be available at some point in the future if the Angels continue to, you know, trend downward, don't make the playoffs maybe a couple years in a row. The Angels historically in recent years have been weak at two spots, and that's pitching and catching. So you could see why they would be interested in someone like Ryan Weathers. Mackenzie Gore was probably involved in talks. Luis Camposano, Mason Thompson would be a great bullpen piece for them. If they can see an opportunity where they can part with someone like Shohei Ohtani, who's one of their big pieces, still hang on to their other big pieces like Trout, Walsh, Rendon, and get really solid young pitching to kind of build a more complete team without superstar player, it's possible that the Angels could do that. The other big takeaway I'm getting from this is AJ Preller is still being really aggressive. Just when we think that he can't outdo himself after trading for Yu Darvish, Blake Snell, and Joe Musgrove in the same offseason, the man goes after Shohei Ohtani. He's somehow found a way to get more aggressive than he actually, you know, already has been. And what this could lead to is there's other star players that, even though it wouldn't really make sense for them to be dealt. Guys like Brian Reynolds, Ketel Marte, I'm not going to say Mike Trout because I'm not going to get too ridiculous, but I mean, guys like Reynolds and Marte who aren't on very good teams and, you know, could potentially be pried away with a package that completely blows the other GM away. AJ Preller could very well pull off a deal like that. He's done the impossible before. And right now it's really telling that he's going after big name players and he's trying to pull off a mega trade. So that's one of the names he's going after. Number two, everyone knows about this one, so I'm just going to get out of the way. He's very interested in Joey Gallo. There's already precedent there. The Padres and Rangers have talked about Gallo before. The Rangers wanted an absolutely ridiculous return for him last time they talked. They wanted CJ Abrams. They talked about Luis Patino. And what makes me think the deal will finally happen this deadline is they talked about Luis Campusano. Right now, AJ Preller is pretty inclined to trade Luis Campusano. Not necessarily because he doesn't believe in him or he wants to, but because we have Austin Nola. Victor Caratini's been fairly solid. Not the best hitter, but you know, he's controlling the staff well. Got a little bit of power. And you even have a nice young catcher in Brandon Valenzuela, who's in, A-ball right now. Switch hitter, good defender. He has some sneaky left-handed pop. You have Nola for, you know, what, I think 4 or 5 years. And then Brandon Valenzuela could potentially take that spot. Our catching depth is perfectly fine. Campusano is a really nice prospect. And in order to get a really nice piece like Gallo, you're going to have to give up someone like that. And the Rangers like him. They talked about him for Gallo before. Gallo has less control right now, so therefore he's going to cost less. I think it's a perfect matchup. I think it's very likely you see Joey Gallo for Luis Campusano. And another thing I've heard that's very interesting, the Rangers are also interested in Ryan Weathers, who is kind of being shopped right now. And the Padres right now are thinking of packaging Gallo and Gibson for Campusano and Weathers. I don't know if that's going to happen. I think it's possible that the Padres give up a little bit less, but Gallo and Gibson are the two big names I'd look out for, and I think are the most likely to become Padres. And then last but not least,
I just wanted to add, I think that we had an episode on Gallo a little bit, and we were talking about that. And we brought up Weathers and Campo as like guys that could potentially be moved. And I think I believe it was in the comments, some listeners were talking about like, that's a lot. And you even brought up Gallo. So I was just wondering if that's too much, but they wanted both those guys, could you potentially see a three-team deal maybe where Gallo shopped and then a different starting pitcher is shopped to the Padres?
Yeah, that's entirely possible. I'll bring a couple of things. Number one, there are a little bit of concerns in the organization with Ryan Weathers. He's had a couple instances where he gets dead arm. Basically what that means is, you know, he had a start in Arizona not too long ago where all of a sudden he came out and he's throwing 89 on his fastball and he wasn't hurt. It's just, you know, his velocity was way down. That's happened to him a couple times before. So they're not necessarily as high on him as his numbers might suggest. But you're right. That is a little bit too much to give up for Gibson and Gallo. And AJ Preller loves three-team deals. Last offseason, he was heavily involved in three-team trade talks for Josh Hader. Which I can confirm now that the third team that things got really like deep with was the Arizona Diamondbacks for Eduardo Escobar would have been going to Milwaukee. I'll throw that out there because I'm pretty sure the reason that White Sox trade for Eduardo Escobar is being held up because the Brewers want him now. So throw that out there for when Eduardo Escobar becomes a Brewer, you guys can credit me. But I think you're absolutely right. I think AJ, in order to lessen the cost or maybe get back a better return, maybe goes out, tries to find a third team, tries to maybe get some prospects going to the Rangers, maybe even try to get a better pitcher coming back to the Padres. So good. It's a great point. You know, he likes to be creative. He likes to maximize his return or minimize, you know, what he's given up. So that's something we could see. So I'll get into the last name. This is a bit of a strange one. This one caught me completely off guard, but I guess it makes sense. Kenta Maeda, the Minnesota Twins, is a big target for us right now. And I think because of his low price tag, because of how horrible he's been this year, I think he's got an ERA of like 6 right now. He's got close to -1 WAR. I think it's pretty likely he ends up in San Diego just because we're interested in him. And I don't see the Twins wanting to actually hang on to him. He's got a cheap contract. And one thing you got to remember is last year he was top 3 in AL Cy Young voting. He was very good. You know, obviously not a stuff kind of pitcher, you know, control and feeds off of a good slider. He's a pretty interesting option as an innings eater coming in, you know, in for a team where guys like Snell, Lamet, Weathers, even Musgrove recently have struggled to go 5 or more innings. Some of them have dealt with injuries. Weathers is on an innings limit. You know, the Padres really looking for a guy that can eat innings, not necessarily an impact starter. So I think Maeda probably comes over, and that's it's an interesting target. Obviously a very high ceiling. He's buying low on him. So that's what I got for you guys today. Otani, not likely. Gallo, Gibson, and Maeda, very likely.
Yeah, you know, us going after Shohei Ohtani does definitely show that AJ Preller wants to win now, that the owners of the Padres, the Seedlers, want to win now as well. They're all in on winning this year. They're all in on taking advantage of, you know, the Tatises, Machados, you know, having Myers out there. He's not having a great year, but you always want to see Myers win. He's been the longest tenured Padre. He's had to go through a lot, as, you know, we've been the team in the cellar for so long. So it'd be great to see him win. But we've seen AJ Preller pull off a lot of trades, and I wouldn't be surprised if he pulls off some of these trades without giving up, you know, Weathers, or I feel pretty positive that Campy will be gone and Mateo will almost certainly be gone, which is kind of an exciting thing for us to hear. No offense to the guy. I hope he goes on and he succeeds somewhere else, but let's be real. He hasn't succeeded with us, so is what it is. But Gallo and Gibson was something that I kind of thought about not that long ago too. Kyle Gibson doesn't have very many, you know, he doesn't have great career numbers, but we can only go based off this year right now. And he has really good numbers right now with the Rangers. He's thrown a lot of innings. I think the lowest he's thrown is 5 1/3, which, you know, which is great considering Lamet was only going 5 5 1/3. Weathers is highest besides today, I believe, was 5 1/3. You know, Musgrove has been having some iffy outings. Blake Snell, 5 1/3 is a blessing for him. So, you know, having someone that can go 5 1/3, 6 7 consistently would be absolutely amazing, even if he's not an amazing pitcher. You know, even if it's Kyle Gibson, who, you know, really didn't have his name on the radar as one of the better pitchers in the league until this year. But the whole point of that trade would be to get Joey Gallo, who has really, even though the average doesn't speak, he has really good numbers. We're not going to complain about an almost 900 OPS. You know, that's amazing. That's something really good to see out of a position where, you know, Will Myers is kind of struggling a little bit. But you put Gallo there and maybe you platoon Hosmer and Myers, or, you know, you get someone else to play first base, considering Hosmer has not been an amazing solution. Yes, he has his clutch moments, but the negative WAR kind of shows that he's not been a very valuable piece of the Padres as of this year. As of his whole tenure with the Padres, he has a negative WAR. So, yes, he does have some great clutch moments. And I know for some people, he probably does pass the eye test, but you got to look further into it. He doesn't really help us out as much as we think. So you put a guy like Gallo into the lineup, and now your lineup is looking deadly, especially considering he goes on tears where he hits a home run in 5 games in a row. He goes on those kind of tears. He's one of the best power hitters in the league, in my opinion. But, you know, you were bringing up Kenta Maeda. I think something that might go unnoticed is that he's played in the NL West before. Maybe it's not all the same names, but he was on the Dodgers for a while. You know, he had Bellinger on his team. He had Seager on his team. He faced Mookie Betts in the World Series. He's, you know, he's maybe not been through that whole same lineup. That lineup hasn't been the same, but he has some experience, you know, with that lineup. And he has some experience within the NL West. So I think that's something pretty cool to think about. He hasn't been the best pitcher. You never know what he can do with us, though, especially considering he would probably be cheap, really cheap option. The Twins are definitely looking to be sellers. There's no question they're going to look to be sellers. And we've brought up Berrios, too. And he's not a very likely option, but we think that would be a cool option too. But definitely the main names I think that are popping up around the Padres community are Gibson, Gallo, and Maeda. And Chase has brought up Alcantara and Marte. Marte's looking to get extended. The Marlins are looking to extend him. We don't know how big the deal will be, but that will definitely raise his price in terms of the trade. So definitely looking forward to seeing what happens at the trade deadline. And it's showing that AJ Preller is willing to win right now. And going for Shohei Ohtani, you're going for the biggest prize in possibly the league right now. You're going for the front runner in the AL MVP. You know, that just shows you're all in right now. The only reason I wouldn't want Ohtani is because he might take that MVP from Tatis. And I don't want that to happen, but I also want a World Series, so I'm okay with that.
I think the Ohtani deal is obviously the most crazy one. And like you said, Ryan, you said you were told less than 1% chance that would go down. Makes a lot of sense. I think the Gallo one is the most likely one to happen. Also cool that you brought back up the Josh Hader stuff and kind of why that went down. And I remember, I think we talked about it on the show, but one of the big issues why the Padres didn't want to really get that one done was because Java Joe was going to be involved. And I think all Padres fans are happy that that didn't go down because – and I think that makes sense. So, and then moving on to, you know, who else do we talk about here? Maeda, I mean, it's kind of an interesting move, a guy that's struggling right now. But you talk about a guy that can be an innings eater, don't even necessarily have to see him in the playoffs, or at least in, you know, meaningful playoff innings, or he's not going to start in the playoffs. So you have a guy like that where he can be that back end of the rotation guy, stepping as the fifth starter. That's a huge help. I mean, if you can just eat up those innings, because right now, I mean, that's the biggest issue for the Padres. We're recording this Tuesday night. Just pitched. He got into the sixth inning, and when a guy gets in, it's a huge win. So I think my Wi-Fi is kind of cutting out a little bit. So Ryan, I'll let you get into like your hypothetical, man. But thanks for sharing with it, because this is really cool stuff. Always cool to see kind of where the Padres are at and who they're talking to. And it's cool to see, even though that Ohtani deal is extremely unlikely, it's cool to see that they're really swinging and really going for something big there.
Yeah. Before I get into my trade deadline hypothetical, I wanted to give a quick shout out to Will Holder on Twitter, who tweeted out a hypothetical Shohei Ohtani trade package that I don't know if he actually knew was like really being discussed between the Padres and Angels, and it made it on MLB Network. And I sent a screenshot of it to my source with the Padres. And I'm like, how does this guy know what's going on? So that was cool. But, so what I want to do is I want to run by you guys a little, mock trade deadline that I put together. I've already tweeted this out. So in my opinion, this covers all the needs that we have as an organization, you know, trying to become World Series contenders, but also I'm trying to keep it realistic. You know, if I really wanted to do what I wanted to do, I would be like, you know, let's trade Mackenzie Gore for Brian Reynolds and, you know, get Max Scherzer and stuff like that. But, you know, obviously not going to happen. So, instead, let me bring up trade number one. Got it written down over here just so I don't mess it up. Oh, let's do it off the top of my head. So trade number one is going to be the Joey Gallo trade. Obviously, we all know that's pretty much going to happen. So I decided to give my version of things and see what you think of it. This is just going to be for Joey Gallo, no Kyle Gibson. I'm not too keen on buying high on a guy like him. you know, who is vastly overperforming his career numbers, like we've seen with the third least valuable player in Major League Baseball, Eric Hosmer. Some people will overperform in years like he did in 2020 and put up a whopping one win above replacement before going back down to where he normally is at negative WAR. There are people that still defend that man. But so for Joey Gallo, my return package is obviously going to be headlined by Luis Campusano. He's, I believe, the number 45 prospect in MLB.com pipeline. One of the top catching prospects in baseball. And I think because he's a catcher, that's such a premium position. He has such a unique offensive skill set at that position. It's going to make him a little bit more valuable than where he's ranked. So I don't see the Rangers complaining about him being the headliner for that trade. They have Sam Huff, who's, you know, a big time catching prospect. He had a 511 foot home run the other day, which is absolutely terrifying. I can't even do that in video games. But he's also 6'5", 240 pounds. Last catcher I remember that was that size was like Jason Castro, maybe Matt Wieters. Very rarely do guys that size, you know, stick at catcher because, you know, they got to stay crouched the whole time, longer legs, bigger frame. So I can see him moving to first, maybe DH, and Campusano, who has a much more projectable frame behind the plate, playing there for them. So he's the headliner. The secondary piece, I don't have Ryan Weathers. I'm going with Tucapita Marcano. Reason being, he's trending up right now. He's having a great season at AAA. I think at one point he hit, you know, four homers in four games in a row, which is, you know, above what he's has been in the past. You know, he was kind of considered a contact first kind of guy. Now he's showing off a little bit more power. He's got some good speed. He's a good fielder. He can play multiple positions. He's ranked number five in our organization. He's very close to the majors. So I can see the Rangers maybe viewing him as having the talent of a top 100 prospect and, you know, willing to take him instead of Ryan Weathers. But I decided to throw in some supplemental pieces too for that deal. Reese Nair, who's our number 12 prospect, starting pitcher, good fastball changeup combo, 24 years old, decent numbers in AAA. You know, could be an okay back the rotation arm for them. And then other than that, just a player to be named later, really. You know, that's two top five prospects from our organization and the number 12 for a year and a half of Joey Gallo. I don't see them saying no to that. You know, some people might even like say, you know, they need Robert Hassel or CJ Abrams for that. And I don't see that. Most trades realistically, you know, end up being less than what people think. So I'll let you guys tell me what you think about that trade.
Not opposed to it. I'm not opposed to it at all. You know, I think the big W there is you get to keep Ryan Weathers. You know, there's a lot of fans that love Ryan Weathers. I love Ryan Weathers too. I think he's an amazing pitcher. I think he's going to be a great pitcher down the road. Even if he's not an ace, he's going to be an amazing two or three. That's for sure. We brought up the whole dead arm thing. Yeah, he does have dead arm. Maybe it's something that can be fixed. Who knows? But we know how much of a talented pitcher he is, and I'm not opposed to giving him up because I know that if we do give him up, it'll be for something good. But I do want to keep him for sure. I want him to be in the Padres' future plans. But when you get a guy like Joey Gallo, like I said, the average doesn't really speak volumes to the rest of his stats. He's getting on now. An amazing rate right now, almost four times out of every 10 at-bats. And his OPS is almost at 900. So it's definitely something you want on your team, something you want batting second or seventh in your lineup because, you know, you want him to be able to get on. You want someone to be able to get on for Tatis or you want someone to be able to get on at the bottom of the lineup. So that way, you know, when the top lineup goes back, he's on. And, you know, he's a really good athlete. He hits for a lot of power, and he's definitely going to be someone that the Padres are going to value very high. Obviously, AJ Preller values him a lot. I've always brought it up. I he does have a high strikeout rate, which I know down the road is going to make me mad, but I won't be mad when he hits a 400-foot tank. So that, I'm going to be okay with that. I've kind of brought up Tucapito Marcano a lot, and I've always said I think he's just going to end up being a trade piece. Just because he doesn't – I'm not going to say he doesn't – his game doesn't translate well to the MLB. He's an amazing – you know, he has a lot of heart. I love seeing that guy go out there and, you know, hustle down the line and give all his heart. It, like, I really like to see that kind of player. He's an amazing – you know, he's a good talent. But, you know, you brought up how he's starting to hit for some power. And I think you trade him at his highest point while, you know, team C, he's starting to hit for power. He has a lot of hustle. He, you know, he can be an everyday player. And if not an everyday player, because let's be real, he's going to be a depth piece for us. A good depth piece, yes. But we want players that are going to produce every single day. Will Tucapita do that for us? No. But will he do that for another organization? Yeah, probably. He probably will. So absolutely some good trade pieces. I'm a big fan of Luis Campusano. I'm not opposed to giving him up, though. Nola's a great hitting catcher. Caratini, like you said, he's been holding down the fort when it comes to managing this staff. He's been, you know, we call him Victor Clutchatini because of how many clutch moments he has. So, you know, it's really good to see Victor Caratini going out there and helping out this team a lot. You know, I feel like the same thing with Gallo, with Caratini. The average doesn't really speak to how well he's been doing with us. He's had some clutch moments. Yes, Eric Hosmer has too, but at least Victor Caratini doesn't have a negative WAR. So, I'm excited to see what this trade deadline brings. You know, we brought up it's probably going to be a slow trade deadline. The draft's coming up soon. We got to know what we're going to have coming in the draft. But that's my opinion on it. I definitely think it'd be a great thing to get Gallo for that price.
I like that you ended your statement with "for that price," because that's kind of where I'm at with Gallo as well. That's the big issue is what's the price going to be? Because if it is Weathers and Campusano, those two guys for Gallo, if that's just the trade, I'm a little hesitant for that. And I think a lot of people are, and I think that's completely fair. Like those are one, that's a guy that's proven himself to be an MLB pitcher. That is, he's been very successful early on. We've talked about how he's a Dodger killer, kind of took that Eric Lauer role. But and then also Campusano, I like that, Brian, that you brought up where he's at. He's ranked 45th in on MLB.com. And then you bring up he's a catcher. That is a marquee position. And not only is he's not just a great, defensively, he's a very, very good offensive catcher. And that's something that is rare. That's why Austin Nola not being in the lineup has such a huge impact. And even when Victor Caratini's there, like, you're still missing Austin Nola's impact. Like, that's been a big issue, I think, for this Padres lineup early on. So those type of guys are incredibly valuable. So if you end up trading Campusano and the offer that you said, I do like that a lot. I think a Gallo, Tatis, Machado back-to-back-to-back is absolutely disgusting. And yes, Gallo's not the perfect player. Well, if you miss a pitch to Gallo, Tatis, or Machado, that's a run. So I'm totally fine with you know, kind of working with him in terms of, you know, he's going to strike out a lot. That's the case. Also, someone brought up their strikeout rates this year. His strikeout rate is not much higher than Tatis's. And that was like a week ago. That was a listener. It wasn't that much higher. So maybe it's improved. And I know that it's been talked about before, like, oh, he's going to improve this. But I really like it. I think it's a good move, Ryan. But what else you got for us in this hypothetical trade deadline situation?
All right. So now I'm going to read off it because now we're getting a little into the deeper parts of the farm system. By the way, I missed a player that you could throw in with Gallo. This is kind of optional, but I also suggested Nabil Chrismat just because I don't have him fitting into the bullpen after all of these trades happen. You know, I'm a fan of him being crafty and like not throwing fastballs and stuff like that. And I think he can be valuable. I just don't see him doing that on our team. I feel like, you know, he can go to a place like Texas where they're going to give him innings and he can kind of create a career there. So, you know, you could throw him in there for Texas as kind of an innings eater type going back for Gallo. But my next trade is just a quick one. This one might not happen because this team can't decide whether they want to contend or not. And that is the Los Angeles Angels. It's not Shohei Ohtani, so let's take a deep breath there. It's actually their closer, Raisel Iglesias. And because he's on a one-year rental contract, that's $9 million, which is pretty expensive for a closer. I only have this given up Yuji Rosario. He's a second base prospect for us. I can't remember where he ranks in our system. It's around the 20 spot. That's normally what you see for a deal like that. Iglesias is good, but he's not, elite, I would say. So, we're giving up a decent little prospect, one-year rental. Iglesias has been pretty, pretty good lately, and his stuff's great. He, 98, 99, able to paint the corners with that fastball, and he's got great breaking stuff. He's got a great changeup. So I'm bringing him into the bullpen mix. I'm really a big fan of stacking up the bullpen and fortifying it for the stretch, because I feel like if you have a shutdown bullpen in the postseason, it's game over. That's the edge there. And since that's a smaller trade, I'll throw out another deal for you guys to talk about, or I'll just throw up the other three I have on here, because they're all kind of smaller, less significant deals. My other two trades, one's going to be with the Detroit Tigers, and that's going to be for infielder Jonathan Scope and their closer Gregory Soto. I have us giving up Tirso Ornelas, who's an outfield prospect, Carlos Garate, who's a starting pitching prospect, and Charles Aquino, who's a shortstop prospect for us. He's not ranked, but I've seen him getting like a lot of praise lately. He's definitely a standout in our system, who's hitting pretty well at the lower levels. Scope is hitting the cover off the ball. He's hitting in Comerica, which is kind of a smaller ballpark. Sorry, a bigger ballpark. So, imagine what he could do in Petco, where the ball flies out a little bit better. Soto has been good this year. He's an all-star. He's got great stuff, but he hasn't had a great career, and the walks are very concerning. So I can see the Tigers wanting to get rid of him now while he has any value whatsoever. And last but not least, I'm making a deal with the Pirates. It's just a quick trade for an innings eater, Tyler Anderson, who almost no-hit us earlier this year somehow. And we're going to give up Osvaldo Hernandez, who's a left-handed pitching prospect. I think number 27 in our organization, not anything significant, but that's what I have. Bringing in Gallo, Iglesias, Scope, Soto, Tyler Anderson, getting a great right fielder, getting two hard throwing arms in the bullpen, getting a guy who can play first and second base, take at bats from Eric Hosmer, please. And a nice innings eater in the back of the rotation, guy who can get through six or seven, have a couple good starts in or there. So let me know what you guys think.
I am fully on board with adding arms to this bullpen. I don't know if this is still the case, but earlier in the season, the bullpen was on track to throw the most innings ever by a bullpen, which you never want to see. Because this, we're in it for the long run. We got to win. We got to go to the World Series or at least the NLCS. And the only way we're going to be able to do that is with healthy arms in the bullpen who aren't completely fatigued by the end of the season. Mark Melanson has gone out there throwing a lot of innings. Tim Hill has been our Iron Man throwing a lot of innings. Austin Adams, you're starting to see a lot more Austin Adams go out there. Yes, we will probably be getting Matt Strom back here soon. I don't know how soon. Who knows how he's going to be? He's missed a lot of time. So getting two guys to come into the bullpen is absolutely detrimental to this team. It's a huge addition. I forgot if it was two or three guys, but it's huge for this team too, right? Yeah. Huge for this team because, you want more guys to be able to go in there, give Tim Hill the days off. Pomeranz starting to see some more innings. You just want your best arms to go into September and October feeling good. Our best arms being Drew Pomeranz, Tim Hill, Mark Melanson. And yes, Mark Melanson's been blowing some games lately. Today he had a 3-out save. He made it look super easy. So nothing to be worried about with Mark Melanson. Is he a postseason type closer? No, probably not. But you're getting someone who throws 98, 99 now to potentially be a postseason type closer. And does he have the best numbers? No. Is he Josh Hader? No. But if Mark Melanson can't go a day, now you have another certified closer who can go a day, right? So you get more arms in the bullpen, and I think bullpen is kind of like the offensive line of baseball, where you don't really think about it too much, but you absolutely need some good arms in the bullpen for sure. And that's what the Padres are showing, you know, getting guys that can go out there, and they've really held it down. I've been kind of thinking the bullpen doesn't really deserve, if they mess anything up, they don't deserve any slander, because they've been picking up this team the whole entire year. They've been picking up the starters the whole entire year. Shoot, even Craig Stammen's gone out there throwing some amazing innings, right? So they've been holding down the fort, but only adding arms to this bullpen is going to make it stronger, going to make us better. You know, getting an innings eater, I would love to have an innings eater right now, absolutely. And that's the whole thing with this bullpen. You know, you want to keep their arms fresh, and maybe he doesn't have to throw every fifth day. He can throw, you know, if Lamet is hurt, or Lamet needs, you know, a little more recovery, or Weathers comes out with dead arm, you throw Anderson in there, kind of like Nabil Chrismat right now, and you get him out there, and you know, he throws a couple innings, he throws 5-6 innings. They're not going to be great innings, but they're going to be serviceable innings. This offense should be able to put up 4 or 5 runs for him. But yeah, I like those ideas, and we got to know that other than Mike Clevinger last year, AJ Preller, you know, he added Mitch Moreland, he added Jason Castro, who they're not big pieces, but they're guys who, you know, they came into the lineup and, you know, maybe they had a little bit of their struggles. They didn't live up to it very much, but they were serviceable and they helped us out.
Yeah, I like most of the moves. I think, like you were saying, Isaac, the bullpen moves, I think those are excellent. We were really big on that. My like wish list for the Padres has been a starter, 2 bullpen arms, and an outfielder. That's what I think they should go after. I was a little bit interested in Jonathan Schoop just because you have Kim as kind of a backup infielder. Obviously, you have Hosmer there. Like, there's a lot of infielders on this team, so that was a little bit interesting to me. Not because, like, I think he's a very good player, but just because the fit is a little odd, just considering how many guys are there right now. So, but the thing is, like, if a guy's tearing the cover off the baseball, like, you find a spot for him. And depth is very good in this league, especially, you know, in how long baseball is, and especially with how many injuries we've seen the Padres come down with. So I don't dislike that move, but I was a little bit, I guess, surprised by that one. But I do like the fits. I think overall they're good trades. You brought up Gallo earlier. I mean, I feel like that's the one that we're all kind of expecting to happen, at least all of us in here. And I like it also because you do get to keep a guy like Ryan Weathers. And even though you mentioned, you know, there's some questions with Weathers with the dead arm, and also his advanced analytics, like you were saying, like kind of like the questions with him are like his advanced analytics aren't great. He's not crazy swing and miss guy, but he's been so good early on. So it's tough to give up a guy like that. And it's tough if you're already giving up a guy like Luis Camposano in that big deal. So I think overall, I think this is a pretty realistic trade deadline scenario. We'll see how many you get right, Ryan. But I like it. And anything else you want to add before we kind of take off out of here?
Yeah, I think I'll wrap that up because, you know, I rattled off all the moves that I'm talking about without really explaining it. So I'll go into a little bit of detail. So Gallo, obviously I haven't taken over in right field for Will Myers. Where I have Will Myers moving to, I basically have him sliding into Jerks and Profar's slot as kind of the backup first baseman outfielder. He hasn't been that great, but he hasn't been terrible as well. So I think he can definitely provide, you know, a lot of decent innings, corner outfield, first base, giving people days off. With Jonathan Schoop, I'm actually sending Ha-Seong Kim down to AAA. And the reason for that is while Ha-Seong Kim's been good, he's been very good defensively, and he's been all right offensively. He's had some nice moments, flashed some of the power that we knew he had. I don't feel like he's developing well at the major league level. I feel like there's loads of potential there that is kind of being wasted because he's more or less been thrown into the deep end instead of being gradually built up to major league pitching. He's gone from KBO straight to MLB, which, you know, it's not Japan in the KBO. It's not really at the level of AAA. It's a little bit lower than that. So, you know, I think he probably should go get some seasoning down in the minors, and he definitely, in my opinion, come out more improved. Schoop is a rental. And where I have him fitting in is at first base with Cronenworth staying at second. I know sending down Kim leaves a bit of a hole. You know, who can play shortstop? Jake Cronenworth. You know, bringing in Jonathan Scope, he can slide over to second base when Fernando needs a day off. Cronenworth can play short, and unfortunately, Eric Hosmer can play first base. You know, or Will Myers, someone like that. You know, we have that depth and that flexibility to where I think we can get Kim some at bats in the minors, get Scope's really powerful, really good bat in the lineup, and give Fernando days off with Cronenworth backing up. Even Machado can play a little bit of shortstop with Iglesias and Soto, which, by the way, I want to point out, if I'm not giving up enough for them, I don't mind throwing in, you know, another minor league piece or two for them. I realize maybe that Soto show trade is a little lopsided coming over to us, so, you know, you can throw in another minor leaguer. But I have Nabil Crismat and Nick Ramirez getting out of the bullpen. Ramirez and Crismat probably go to AAA, maybe get traded. I'm doing this assuming Matt Stroman and Nelson Lamet won't be healthy. Obviously, they probably will, but I feel like if you're going for a World Series, you have to assume the worst. You have to assume that the players that are underperforming right now are going to continue to underperform, and you have to assume that there's going to be a lot of injuries. So those two guys go to the back end of the bullpen. And then Tyler Anderson obviously slots back into the rotation. You can send Ryan Weathers down. You can send someone else down and keep Weathers in the bullpen. You know, there's a lot of ways you could do that. So, yeah, that's what I got. It's not necessarily the most ideal, but I feel like it's very realistic. It fills all our needs. And honestly, I think it puts together a nice World Series roster. You get Schilp's power, Gallo's walks and power in the lineup. You get a nice bullpen. So that's what I got.
Yeah, no, I definitely like it, man. And I think we'll wrap it up right here. We got a very long episode today, but it's exciting stuff. So had to talk a long time about it. Also, Ryan, having you on, you on a really good time and a long time. So it was really cool to have you on. Really appreciate you kind of sharing what you've heard. Really exciting stuff. Pretty insane that Preller went, and even though Otani's going to be the MVP in the AL, that he said, hey, I'll take a swing. I'll send an offer this way. So once again, thanks for coming on, man, and really appreciate it. Anyone listening, let us know what you think about these deals. I know we've talked about Gallo in the past. Haven't really talked about some of the other guys, and also Ryan's hypothetical. Haven't brought up many of those guys. But I want to hear kind of your thoughts on everyone there. There's definitely a lot to take from this episode. So let us know what you think, and we'll talk to you guys very soon.